Hello, my name's Robert Dean Steele. This is your Cornerstone Community Church service for January the 14th, 2024. And we're so glad to have you join us today. Our doors. Now, I want to invite you to our in-person service, which will be held at Cornerstone Hall, number 6 Taché Street in St. Albert. Our doors open at 10:45 and our service starts at 11 a.m. Let's open our time with a word of prayer. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and the opportunity that, Lord, we have to enjoy the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And now we ask your blessing upon our service in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm casting my cares aside, leaving my past behind, setting my heart and mind on you, Jesus. Reaching my hands to you, leaving me so much more, knowing that all I have in store for me is good. Today is the day that you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day that we're going to be following the Lord and doing what He wants us to do. Well, there's an old song called, I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood atoning, and I repented of my sins and won the victory. a great way to start our time off together, giving that victory that we have in Jesus Christ. Well, today we're going to be looking at the story of Sennacherib and the story of Hezekiah. So, Father, we thank you today for this wonderful opportunity to look at God's word. And we ask your blessing upon it now in Jesus' name. So in Isaiah 36, it says, in the 14th year of Hezekiah's reign, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, attacked the fortified cities of Judah and captured them. So this is the background of where we're going to find ourselves the next several weeks. So Sennacherib, in the 14th year of Hezekiah's reign, came down and attacked the fortified cities of Judah. Then the king of Assyria sent his field commander with a large army at Lachish to King Hezekiah at Jerusalem. So he stopped at Lachish, which is a northern city that is still in the territory of Israel and also Judah. And so that's where he was. He sent a very large army down there. And when the commander stopped at the aqueduct of the upper pool on the road to the launderer's field, Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, the palace administrator, Shebna, the secretary, and Joash, the son of Asaph, the recorder, went out to meet him. So he's out about 5 miles north of the city, okay, in the area where people were actually did their laundry. And they met there. Eliakim, of course, was the palace administrator, and Shebna was the secretary. He would write down what was going on, and Joash, the son of Asaph, the recorder, went out to him. So there were three of the officials that came out from Judah, and this was often the way that things went. And they went out there to find out exactly what it was that Sennacherib wanted. So the field commander said to them, tell Hezekiah. Now, what he's doing is he's reading a letter from Sennacherib. And he says, this is what the great king of Assyria says. What are you basing your confidence on? So he's asking a question. Hezekiah, what are you basing your confidence on? He says, where do you get the chutzpah to actually rebel against the king of Assyria? Okay. Now, the king of Assyria was down there for a particular reason. The particular reason was conquest. The particular reason was booty, and getting riches from Hezekiah. He heard that Hezekiah had a few riches, and so he wanted not only the riches, he wanted all the territory. He was on his conquesting type of, he was creating an empire is what he was doing. And this little vassal state, this state between him and Egypt, you know, he was actually standing in the way of him going down to Egypt. So he says, what are your confidence? They say you have counsel and might for war. That's what he says. He says, you have all these armies ready to go and fight for you, but you're only speaking empty words. And on whom are you, whose confidence are you on when it comes to rebellion against me? As far as Sennacherib is concerned, Hezekiah is rebelling against him. I mean, how dare you stand up against me? Now, there's in every way, Sennacherib is a classic bully, okay? He figures, I've got the armies, I've got this mandate, you know, from his god Nishrak, because that was who his god was. And he says, how dare you rebel against me? Okay, so he says, look, if you're depending on Egypt, that splintered reed or of a staff, which pierces the hand and that everyone leans on, such as Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and all who depend on him. He says, if you are relying on Egypt, well, you know, his strength is going to break, just like a reed breaks in the hands of a man and gets pierced. And he says, and if you say to me, well, we're depending on the Lord our God, Isn't he the one whose high places and altars Hezekiah removed, saying to Judah and Jerusalem, you must worship on this altar? So he says, if you are also relying on the Lord God, well, what about all these high places and all these altars that Hezekiah had gone through the land and had removed? Now, you have to understand, this king and also his field commander were polytheistic people. They followed many gods, and they also worshiped idols. And so it was hard for them, impossible for them to understand the Lord God Almighty. And they couldn't understand why it was that Hezekiah had removed all the idols, all the shrines, all the high places, and told everybody to come back to the city of Jerusalem and worship there, because that's where the temple was. In their minds, they couldn't comprehend that, okay? And of course, when you don't know the Lord, your mind is darkened. And secondly, what happens is that it is impossible for you to understand spiritual truth and truth about the Lord. So he simply, you know, but it also gives you a knowledge that Sennacherib knew what was going on in Jerusalem. He had his spies there as well. So he says, come, let's make a bargain. The king of Assyria will give you 2,000 horses, and if you can find riders on them, and if you can repulse one officer of the least of my master's officials, even though you're depending on Egypt for chariots and horsemen, he says, I'll tell you what, we're going to make a little deal here. And the deal is, if you can find 2,000 riders, and I will give you 2,000 horses. And he says, even if you're depending on Egypt or, of course, their chariots and their horses, he says, you're not even going to be able to repulse one division of my great army. Furthermore, I have come to attack and destroy this land without the Lord. The Lord himself told me to march against this country and destroy it. Now, that was an out-and-out lie. He basically says, I am here. I have been mandated by the Lord himself, which was, of course, not true. But you see, this was an intimidation tactic. And that's often what the enemy does. He comes in and says, okay, who are you depending upon? Are you depending upon your own strength? Are you depending upon your own creativity? Are you depending on all your resources? They're going to fail. And in that respect, he's absolutely right. But here this guy comes in and he says, actually, I have a mandate from heaven to do this. I am destined to do this. And I'm coming here to destroy. And that was an out-and-out lie. And so then Eliakim, Shebna, and Joab said to the field commander, please speak to your servants in Aramaic, since we understand it. Don't speak to us in Hebrew in the hearing of the people of the wall. So they had a simple request. They said, listen, why don't you speak to us in Aramaic? That, of course, was the common language of that time where people interacted from nations. It was kind of like the English of the day, the international language of commerce and also trade. But he was speaking in Hebrew, and the whole idea was to intimidate. The whole idea was to create fear. And this is what the enemy does. So what we see today is this, the classic attack of the enemy. Now, we need to realize Jesus said in John 10:10 that the thief comes to rob, kill, and destroy. And one of his methods is accusation, temptation, and deception. That's what we see. We know that the field commander and Sennacherib were lying. They, first of all, used the common tactic. Who are you relying on? Are you relying on some outside force to come and protect you? Are you relying on the Lord? And in the mind, again, of Sennacherib, he had a mandate from heaven, from destiny. And so he brings all of these things to intimidate, to create fear, to create a sense of hopelessness. And they did it in the language of the people. The people understood. This field commander was speaking in Hebrew, obviously. He had a knowledge of the language. And so when the officials, of course, made that demand or said, don't do that, we'll find out next time that he absolutely refuses to do that. And but today we see the classic duel, the classic battle between light and darkness, between truth and lies, between righteousness and unrighteousness. And this is so much what's going on in our world today. We have this battle between good and evil. We have this classic schism and to and fro and ebb and flow. And so we have to make decisions just like the people of that day. Are we going to believe the report of the enemy, or are we going to believe the report of the Lord? That's the decision that we have to make. So Father, today, just like in those days, our world is in conflict. Lord, we have the truth, and then we have the lies. We have the enemy, and we have our relationship with God. And who are we going to depend upon? Are we going to depend on our own resources? Are we going to depend on the government or some system to protect us? Or are we going to put our trust in the Lord? Well, I trust that we'll put our trust in you. So, Father, today, enable us, Lord, to repulse the lies of the enemy in whatever form they come, and especially those who believe that they have a mandate and a destiny from heaven, which they don't. So, Lord, enable us, Lord, to be discerners of the truth, and also as well, Lord, wise as serpent and harmless as doves. Thank you for this now in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to pray for you right now. So whether your need is physical, spiritual, emotional, intellectual, financial, or family, I want you to know that God can do exceedingly abundantly beyond what you're able to ask or even imagine. So Lord, whether it is provision or healing, today we are praying for the people of God. And we're asking that, Lord, right now, in this moment, that your healing hand is going to be upon your people. 1 Peter 2:24 is the scripture that we stand upon today that says, by your stripes we're healed. So, Lord, right now, in the name of Jesus, we are receiving your healing, not just for ourselves, but for our family and friends or someone that has going to come across our path today. Secondly, Lord, we live in a time where inflation and taxes and so many other things are coming against our paycheck. And we look at our paycheck and it's getting smaller instead of larger. Father, today in the name of Jesus, would you right now meet every need? Would you right now in this moment supply according to your riches and glory? And we thank you for this now in Jesus' name, that you are Jehovah Jireh. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, we're going to close our time together today with "This Is the Air That I Breathe." This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my is so true. We need the presence of the Lord every single day. Well, of course, I want to invite you to our in-person service today at 11 a.m. We meet at Cornerstone Hall, number 6 Tash A Street in St. Albert, and we would love to have you join us for that service. So, Father, once again, we thank you today for this wonderful opportunity to spend time, Lord, together. And, Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, for the application of the word, the prayer of healing, and also provision, and every other blessing. Now, Lord, we thank you for our time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, my name is Robert Dean Steele. Thank you so much for joining me today. May the Lord bless you, and may you have a beautiful day. And, of course, stay warm. God bless.